from coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let every nation rejoice. Praise the Lord with one mighty voice.
Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world, from the heart of Europe. The tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. To Central and South America. You're a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Join us from the Anaheim Stadium in Anaheim, California for Summer Harvest, featuring pastor and evangelist Greg Laurie and special guests, former Major League pitcher Dave Trevecki and the pastor of Calvary Chapel of Diamond Bar, California, Roy Reese, ministering in music, Dennis Agajanian, Crystal Lewis, John and Dino Elefante, Richie Foray, and the Maranatha Praise Band. And ready to take your calls, prayer partners from around America.
Praise the Lord, let every nation rejoice. Praise the Lord with one mighty voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise.
Now let's join Summer Harvest.
Jesus, mighty God, our rock, our fortress, our
sing with us on this one. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Why don't you go ahead and take a seat? We're going to sing, I Will Celebrate.
With my heart rejoicing within. You all may be wondering who this group of people is out here by the left field foul pole. They haven't decided to form a denomination of their own or anything. That's the worship community. And they're going to join us on a song that says, of all the things out there that we could choose to believe in, we've chosen to believe in the one and only true God. I believe in God the Father, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus, his only Son, born of a virgin birth. On a cross, he was crucified, he descended into hell, but on the third day, Jesus rose again. He's alive and all is well. This is what I believe. Faith is written on my heart. This is what I believe. Every promise, every part. This is what I believe. I believe the Lord's in heaven. Us in the air. I believe he's in the church to keep us on the way, leading onward in the truth through that great eternal day.
Right now, we'd like to welcome an old friend of ours, Richie Furay. He's a founding member of Buffalo Springfield and Poco. He's a pastor now in Boulder, Colorado. We're going to sing with him on a song called Hallel.
Good evening and welcome in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. This time, Raul Reese is going to share with us his testimony.
The scripture says it, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe it on him should not perish but have everlasting life. And when you think of the condition of the world today, and I think of my own life, going back 20 years ago, how God's love was given to me. When I think of my life, I think of a puzzle being put together by my own self until God began to build the puzzle and put everything in its place. I was born in Mexico City in 1947, August the 30th. My father was German. My mother was from New York City. At the time that I was born, my father already was an alcoholic. My grandfather had been taken by the Nazi Germans and had been killed. And my father, at the age of 9 years of age, began to not only take care of his home, but by the time he was 14 and 15 years of age, already he was an alcoholic drinking the pressures of the home. As my father grew up, and as I began to come into the home, my father became an abuser. Not only a physical abuser, but also a verbal abuser of my mother and of the children. And I remember that as growing up, my father coming in the morning, 4 or 5 in the morning, drunk, staggering, blood all over his shirts, and waking up the whole house and making everybody to get out of bed so that he could begin to abuse us. And I remember him taking me to nightclubs and bars at the age of 5 and 6 years of age, sitting there outside while he was drinking and partying, and thinking, when I'm going to go home to be with my mom and to be with my family. And I remember my dad's, kind of coming out of the nightclubs and staggering and getting on one of these little scooters that he had, and getting on the back of the scooter and going out on traffic and almost being killed many times, and getting home and then continuing his verbal abuse. And then in 1957, when my mother had had enough of abuse, she took us to Los Angeles, California, where my grandparents had not only exited out of Mexico because they were from Spain, but my grandfather had come to Los Angeles. And they had taken us in, and so my mother thought we would begin a brand new life. And I remember that when we came to America, I thought it was the greatest thing, because now we got rid of the problem. No more screaming, no more yelling, no more beatings. No more being put in the room for, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours, sometimes a whole day without going eating and drinking as punishment. And I remember a year as we came to the United States of America in 1958, where my dad wrote to my mother and said that he wanted to get together, that he was going to change his ways. And I remember my mother talking to us and saying that he was going to let him come. At that point in time, I was about 10 years of age. And I remember begging my mother, please don't let him come. I don't want him here. And my mother went ahead and let him come, and he made all the promises. But as he came, he began to drink. He began to, again, abuse verbally, physically. And then from Los Angeles, we moved out to Montebello, California, and we lived there about 2.5 years, and he continued his drinking parties, and he began his abuse. And I remember being in junior high school, thinking that one day when I grew up, I would kill my father because I hated him so much. And then we made the move to Baldwin Park. At the time, I was a freshman in high school. And I remember moving into Baldwin Park and starting high school as a freshman. And I was always embarrassed to bring my friends home because I knew my dad was going to be drunk. And he always wanted to start hassles with everybody. When any time the school would call my father, I was totally ashamed, because usually there was alcohol under his breath, or he would be staggering, and I would never ever be able to show anybody who my father really was. And during that time, I began to rebel against my home and everybody else. And of course, I began to get in trouble with the police. I became very violent. And at the age of 18 years of age, after being kicked out of high school, in and out of high school, at the age of 18, I almost killed some young man from Edgewood High School. And I remember the police coming to get me about 3 weeks before I graduated from high school, and the guy was in pretty bad shape, and they wanted me to pay for all the bills. And I went to court, and they told me that I either go to jail or I had the opportunity as I was graduating to go in the military. So I chose the United States Marines. I took the test, passed it, went into the United States Marines. And now when I went into Marine Corps, I thought I'm going to be the best in everything that I do. And so when I graduated from the United States Marine Corps, after 12 weeks of training, I got the high PT man doing physical fitness. I got out of 500 points, about 495 points. And I thought, man, you know, that's great. I'm doing great. And then I got my orders to go to Vietnam. So I said, well, since I'm going to Vietnam, I'm going to become not only the best fighter, but then now I got a license to really use my violence, and I have a license to kill. So I remember my father and my brother Xavier and my friend Champ Oxenham taking me down to Camp Pendleton as I would take a ship from San Diego. And I remember departing on that ship with 5,000 troops to Vietnam on December the 7th, 1966. My thoughts were, as I was looking at San Diego, as we were departing on that ship, will I ever, ever come back? I never thought about heaven or hell. All I thought is that would I ever come back to the United States of America? And on the way to Vietnam, it took about 26 days to get to Vietnam. We stopped in Okinawa, and when we had about 2 days leave, during that whole time with the Navy and the Marines, we had a big drunken thing, and we got in a fight with some of the Navy guys, and two of the Navy guys were killed in a nightclub. And I remember going back to the ship and going over to Vietnam. Within 24 hours, I saw the land of Vietnam. We landed in Da Nang. And I remember getting off that huge troop, you know, ship, getting my orders, and what they told me is I have to go to Alpha Company 1-7. And when I went to the Alpha Company 1-7, they took me. And when I got there, they put me in a platoon, and they told me, since you're the booty, you're the guy coming in fresh, you're going to take the point. Well, usually the guys on the point always get killed first, or they step on a booby trap and they have no legs. But I decided I was going to be a survivalist. I decided that now I have a time, you know, and I have a license to kill. So what I did is I joined, we made a pack. I remember my first platoon going out, my first ambush killing the first VC. As the heaven of us took a pack, a blood pack, as we killed a young man and we put our hand into the blood and we tasted the blood of the Viet Cong, and we made a pact that nobody was ever going to let us to take us captive, and if anybody would ever ambush us and they were going to take us as POWs, that nobody would do it, we would commit suicide. And so what happened is, after 10 and a half months of being not only blown up once and being shot by a K-47 and spending 30 days in the hospital ship, the U.S. Sanctuary in the Philippines, God again, I didn't know that, but God had a hand upon my life. He spared me. I saw many of my friends get killed. I remember lonely nights and night operations as we were fighting against the VC and setting up the ambushes, thinking, man, am I next? About 10 months after getting into these platoons and going into the ambushes and having all the things that a glory can get of killing people, I told them, I'm not going out anymore. I only have 2 months left. I'm not going anywhere. I began to rebel because I saw those guys that had 30 days leave. You know, they only had 30 days left. They were short timers, and they were getting blown up, and they were getting killed. I said, I'm not going to do that. So they sent me to a psychiatrist in Da Nang, and I told the psychiatrist that if he didn't get me out of the country, I was going to kill him. So he wrote a piece of paper real fast and said, go ahead, go back to your captain. So I took the paper back to the captain. I gave it to him, and he said, Reese, pack all your things. You're going home. So I got excited because I thought I was going home. They got me in one of these big 1C31s, and they strapped me in, and they chained my arms and my legs. And they took me to Japan, to Okinawa, and I landed at Travels Air Force Base there in San Francisco. And they took me up, and they picked me up in a paddy wagon, and they took me to Oakland Naval Hospital, Project 49A, where all the crazy people were. I thought I was going home, so what I did is I rebelled. Dr. Wilson, the psychiatrist, sent me to a project called, not only Project 49A, but it was called Synanon, the beginning of Synanon therapy treatment. And I remember sitting in this group therapy, and I couldn't understand what these guys were saying. I wouldn't tell my story, so I just rebelled and I started beating everybody up. So they got tired of me and sent me back to the psychiatry ward. And they locked me up, and after 6 months, Dr. Wilson said, Reese, we can't do anything with you, so we're going to send you out. You're going to get a dishonorable discharge. I said, I don't really care. So they sent me back here to Camp Pendleton in San Clemente, and they put me away for 3.5 months. During that time, I was writing to my girlfriend, which was Sharon. We had met in high school, and we had fallen in love through letters. And what happened is they gave me a couple of times where Sharon could come and see me, and I went out on liberty and waiting upon my discharge. My wife was backslidden, and what happened, she got pregnant. I got my discharge 3.5 months later on September the 15th, 1967, getting out of the United States Marine Corps with an honorable discharge. I don't know how, it's the grace of God. But as I got out, we got married and lived here in Orange County off of Catella. And then something drove me back from Orange County back to Valvoline Park. We began to live in Covina. I began to go back to my old friends and hang out with my friends and get drunk. And at that time, I was beginning to study the martial arts. And I was partying here and partying there and getting into violence. And I didn't really care. And then I would come home. And then I began to physically, verbally abuse my wife. And it was the grace of God. Because after 4.5 years of total abuse, verbally and physically, my wife was ready to leave me. There was no hope. Even though I was in the martial arts and I was making good money and I was doing everything that everybody in the world can do, I was unhappy, empty, full of hatred. And so I thought, the only way that I can do this, because my wife's going to leave me, I'll kill her and then kill my kids, and then I'll shoot it out with the police. So when I came home that night, my wife's bags were packed, and what happened, she was in church. She had given her life back to the Lord. I began to see that love and that grace and mercy upon her life, but she never preached to me. She just prayed for me and her family. And it made me angry, because when I would come in, even though I would hit her, and I would abuse her, she would just come back with the love of Jesus Christ. And I couldn't understand it. And so that night when I came home, I decided to load up my rifle. And when she would come home, I would kill her and make the plot and then kill my children and then shoot it out with the cops, because I wasn't really afraid to die. I feared no man. And Satan surely had deceived me. And that night, as I waited for my wife to come home, the Holy Spirit had all planned out already. Because Chuck Smith was on TV. As I went to break the TV turned on, and here comes Chuck Smith, and he's speaking about God's grace and God's love and God's mercy. And it was like arrows coming out of that TV, piercing my heart and just melting me, which I had never cried. I had never been soft about it. And all of a sudden, I began to weep. And I said, if there's a God in heaven, please, God, save me, help me. I got on my knees that night and I asked Jesus Christ to come into my life. And from that night on, never ever was it the same, because that night I went looking for my wife because she wasn't home after I had destroyed the home. And I came back home and my wife was already at home. I knocked on the door, and as she opened the door, she opened with a little latch and I could hear her crying. I said, Sharon, why don't you let me in? I've been born again. And she closed the door right in my face because she didn't really believe it, because she knew my life. And even though when she opened the door, it took about two years for her to really see a change in my life. But you know what? Whatever I committed myself to, I committed myself completely. And I have completely committed my life to Jesus Christ, because He is the only way, the only truth, and the only life. And if you're not here, if you're here tonight without the Lord, you're a fool. You're playing Russian roulette with a gun not to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I will conclude with this. A missionary that trained for the ministry, after spending 7 years and getting ready to go to the mission field, to go to China, was killed on the way to China. And when they opened his diary, this is what they found. No regrets, no reserves, no retreat. The Proverbs 28:13 says this, "He that covers his sins shall not prosper, but he that confesses it and forsakes his sins shall have mercy." God bless you.
What a thrill to be here. Thank you so very much. I'm really thrilled to have Rick and Lonnie here singing with me. And the praise band has been so great. And they've been wonderful. And I'm just thrilled that you all came and you brought a friend here. And to be just a small part, every one of us on the platform here. Because the most important thing is the preaching of the gospel. And God has gifted Greg Laurie to do that tonight. And this song is one that talks about a young girl that was lost. She was a prostitute, but God forgave her of everything she'd ever done in her whole life because she accepted Christ. And Jesus has the power to forgive and also to forget everything you've ever done that's wrong.
Texas.
a beautiful ranch, your daddy left home. Her mama found another man, you're on your own. One to love, she hitched a ride and went away to a city out of the country full of shame. Ran out, she'd met a man, she lost her pride. Abused and confused, she started to cry. All the pain I've never known, well, I was daddy's girl. Away from a family in a sinful world. I wanna go home to my father. Walked by a rescue mission and she heard a voice say, to give was all I had, I made a choice. My life was full of shame, Jesus took me all alone. The streets no more, my love was made of stone. I wanna go home to my father. To go home. You sing it with us now, one more time. We love you very much.
The Elefante brothers, John and Dino, are going to be singing, joined, of course, with Richie and the choir. They're going to be singing this song that they have recently written that I think has one of the most dynamic messages that I have heard in quite a while. When will the world see that we need Jesus? The hope of our future doesn't lie with any political party. The hope of our future lies with a commitment to Jesus Christ. That's the only thing that can save our nation and make our nation strong. When will the world see that we need Jesus?
I want to tell you that I've probably written about 150 songs in my career, and never has a song been so special to me and my brother Dino. We've seen this song touch so many lives, and the message is just so simple. When will this world see that we need Jesus? He's the only way out.
And we want you to sing it with us. Just remember those words. When will the world see that we need Jesus?
Son of man, we must live in the shadow of his love.
next fellow I'm going to introduce to you is a fellow that I've come to admire so deeply. I saw him on Barbara Walters in an interview, and I don't think I've ever seen her moved as she was moved when she was talking with him. His witness for Jesus Christ was so dynamic, so powerful, that she was visibly moved as she interviewed him. I believe that he probably gave to her one of the strongest Christian witnesses she has ever received. And I can imagine that as he comes tonight, and right in front of him, he sees the mound which was so familiar to him, that there will be memories that will be welling up inside of a career that was shut short by tragedy, if you want to call it tragedy. But we know that all things work together for good to those that love God, though we don't always understand the purposes or the reason that God has. But surely Dave has turned this cancer into a marvelous platform to share the power of Jesus Christ, the sustaining grace of Jesus Christ in all kinds of circumstances. It's my pleasure and my privilege to introduce to you a man that I admire among all men, Dave Drabecki.
As I stand here before you, and I know that this pitcher's mound is not very far away, I have an awful lot of thoughts about those memories that took place on a mound such as this. And I can tell you from the bottom of my heart that I am much more happier now throwing the pitch that I'm throwing than any pitch I ever threw as a baseball player. You know, Jesus says in his word that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. And as I think of my own life, there was a point in time in my life when I was seeking the way. And it took place in Amarillo, Texas, back in 1981, where I met a man by the name of Byron Ballard. And Byron, in love, began to show me the way. And I'll never forget the challenge that he presented to me that year in 1981, when he took God's word and he challenged me to open up this book and to read it for myself. Because you see, at that point in time in my life, I was searching for something more meaningful. And in the process, Byron in love began to show me who this God is that I had no idea could love me as much as he does. In Romans 3:23, it says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. When Byron shared that verse with me, I was convicted tremendously. I came to grips with the reality that Dave was a sinner and that I was separated from God because of that sin. But ultimately, God wanted to have fellowship with me, and I needed to do something with this sin that was blocking the way. In Romans 6:23, it says that for the wage of sin is death. And when I thought about that, I was overwhelmed with the fact that if I didn't deal with this sin and I ended up in death physically, that ultimately I wouldn't experience just a physical death, but I too would experience a spiritual death. You know, I've heard it said that if you're born once, you'll die twice. But if you're born twice, you'll only die once. At this point in my life, I was searching for the meaning of this and coming to understand that even in the midst of my sin, God loved me. Romans 5:8 says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. To me, that means that God, in his infinite love, his unconditional love, took me just as I am. And he sent his son to die on the cross for my sins so that I might be set free. At one point in time in my life, God was just some big granddaddy in the sky. And now I was beginning to understand that he was a personal God that loved me very much. I'd like to introduce to you tonight a very special person in my life who came along with me on this trip, and that's my daughter, Tiffany. She's sitting on the stage here tonight. The reason I mention her and introduce her to you is because of my love for her. I have a son, Jonathan, at home that's 7 years old, and I love him very much as well. And when I think of my love for my children, I can tell you that I would literally die for my kids. That's how much I love them. And when I think of what I would do to any one of you if you tried to hurt my kids, even with one arm, you can imagine how great that love is. I may lose, but we'll fight a long time. But I can tell you that it would be very hard for me to tell you tonight that I could give my children in death for any one of you. That's how much I love them. How much greater is God's love for us and that he gave his one and only son in death so that we might have life. As Byron took me through the scriptures and shared this tremendous love of God, it began to unfold to me that this way was the way I needed to take, the path I needed to follow. And on August 27th of 1981, by the grace of God and through his mercy, My wife Jan and I entered into a relationship with Jesus Christ, received him as our Savior. What allowed that to happen? It was the conviction of the truth of God's Word. And that is what has set us free to now enjoy this relationship with him, even in the midst of the storm. As I sought the way, he showed me the truth, and now I have life. And that life can only come through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 through 13, it says that he who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. These things I tell you so that you may know you have eternal life. As I stand here before you, there may be many more struggles that lie ahead, and there have certainly been a lot of struggles in the past. But one thing is for certain, God has given me a special gift, and this gift is the gift of eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. And one day, when this passes, I will be able to rejoice in heaven with my Heavenly Father. That is a promise. That is a promise that God extends to each and every one of us, this special gift that he has given through his Son, Jesus Christ. And you know, there may be some of you tonight who do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior. I challenge you tonight, as Byron Ballard challenged me through the Word of God, to respond to Jesus as he stands at the door of your heart knocking. My prayer is that you tonight would turn that knob and open the door and invite him into your life. And from that day forward, from tonight forward, experience the joy of knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus, who loves us so much. In closing, I would like to say that I may stand here before you as an amputee without my left arm, and I may not be able to throw a baseball anymore, but one thing I promise you, you know, I know there's a great baseball player that's still playing this game, that stood on this mound many times throwing 100-mile-an-hour fastballs. That man's name is Nolan Ryan. But I can tell you one thing for sure. When I get to heaven, I'm going to be able to throw a whole lot harder than he ever thought he could with a new arm God gives me. Jesus is standing at the door of your heart, and he's knocking. Please, tonight, open that door and invite him in. God bless you all.
I love that competitive spirit. That's what makes champions. Champions for Jesus Christ, and it's glorious. This time, let's welcome Crystal Hall. Crystal Lewis. Sorry about that, Crystal, my little angel.
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas great that taught my heart to feel, and great my fears relieved. The I first believed through many dangers, toils, and snares I had. Shining as the sun. Cross the
And now we've come to the primary reason for our being here tonight. And that is to share with you what Jesus Christ can do for you if you'll just give him a chance. And thus we ask that there be no more movement around, that you will not leave until you have been dismissed with the benediction, that you will give all attention to the Word of God as Greg comes to share with us this evening. There are lives here tonight whose eternal destinies are being determined by the decisions that they will make. We want them to have a fair opportunity to hear what Jesus Christ can do for them if they will just give him a chance. And so please, no shouting, no distractions, no seeking to draw attention to yourself, for we want to give all the attention to the Word of God as Greg shares with us now what Jesus Christ can do for anyone who will just open their hearts to receive him as their Lord and Savior. I'm pleased to present to you at this time Greg Laurie.
Good evening. Hello. Nice to see it wrapping around tonight with so many new people. How many of you are here for the first time tonight at the Harvest Crusade? Why don't you raise your hand if you're first time? Wow, that's a lot of you. Great, welcome. Well, I don't know, do you think we ought to do this again next year maybe? You know, Pastor Chuck mentioned to you this brochure that tells you a little bit about this ministry that is about 3 years old. And our next stop that we're going to be having for our crusade is Seattle, Washington. And after that, we're going over to Honolulu. And we're going to have a series of meetings in the Waikiki Shell, and we're going to end up in the Aloha Stadium. So there's a lot to continue to pray for. And if you would like to be kept up to date on what God is doing through Harvest Crusades, I would encourage you to take that little part you can tear off and send it on in. And we'll keep you posted on what is happening. And one of the first things we want to do is get to you as quickly as possible a report of all that God has done thus far. So far, we've had 75,000 people in attendance here, not counting tonight. And we've seen over 6,000 people come forward to receive Jesus Christ. So praise the Lord. So if you'd like to be kept up to date, take advantage of this. There's purple boxes as you leave, or you can just drop it into the mail, and we'll look forward to corresponding with you. For every one of these people that have come forward, there's a story to tell. And as we learn more about those stories, we want to share them with you. But I heard about a suicidal girl that came last night. She had attempted suicide only a few days ago, but thank God she had failed. And a considerate Christian friend brought her out last night, and when she heard the gospel, she said, "That's what I need," and she got up out of her seat and went forward and made a commitment to Jesus Christ. So praise the Lord. Maybe you've attempted suicide. You're hurting on the inside. We're going to give to you in a few moments an opportunity to come and meet the God that changed the life of Dave Dravecki, and change the life of David Hawking and Chuck Smith and Raul Ries and Richie Fure and my life and many others around you. He can change you as well. When I first heard the gospel, the good news that God loved me so much that he sent his son to die on the cross, and if I would turn from my sin and turn to him by faith and follow him, I could have a relationship with God and have the hope of heaven. I thought to myself, I'm the one guy that God's going to say no to. I'm the one person that God's going to look at and say, nah, he's not worth the effort. But you know what? I was wrong. Because Jesus said, he that would come to me, I would in no way cast out. You may think you're that person. You might say, hey, I've done so many horrible things in my life. God would never forgive me. God would never change me. You're wrong. He can and he will if you'll give him an opportunity. And when we give that invitation to come down to this field and make a public stand for Christ, I hope you're one of the first ones to come down and you find out what God can do for you. I'd like you to turn in your Bibles now to the Gospel of Luke, the 19th chapter. How many of you brought your Bibles tonight? Let's see them. Oh, yes. Luke chapter 19. The title of this message is God's Answer to Loneliness. Are you a lonely person? You may have no real friends to speak of. Then again, you may have friends, but you feel as there is no one that you can really trust. Even in a laughing crowd or at a party, momentarily loneliness just sweeps over you. The psychiatrist was asked, what is the greatest problem of the patients that come to you for help? And his response was, loneliness. And he went on to say, in fact, it's a loneliness for God. And other experts in his field agree. They say loneliness is the most devastating malady of our age. It is perhaps the most dangerous and widespread illness in our land. It has reached epidemic proportions and continues to spread. Lonely people, as the Beatles sang so many years ago, all the lonely people, where do they all come from? All the lonely people, where do they all belong? Are you a lonely person tonight? Tom Wolfe, the novelist, wrote, loneliness is something that affects everyone. He said, the whole conviction of my life now rests upon the belief that loneliness, far from being a rare and curious phenomena peculiar to myself and a few other solitary men, is the central and inevitable fact of human existence. Experts have found that loneliness is the primary reason that teenagers commit suicide today. One study found that 90% of suicidal adolescents believed that their families did not understand them. They felt isolated, anonymous, and lonely. And even those who are rich and famous, those who are adored by millions, know what it is to be lonely. I read in the newspaper a few months ago one of the last letters that Elvis Presley ever wrote in 1976 when he was appearing at the Las Vegas Hilton. And Elvis wrote these words, I feel so alone sometimes. The night is quiet for me. I'd love to be able to go to sleep. I'm glad everyone is gone now. I'll probably not rest. I don't need all of this. Help me, Lord. Does that sound like you? I read a quote from a famous football player who has had his share of success and fame and fortune. And he said in an interview these words, I sit in my house and sometimes I get lonely, it's unbelievable. Life has been so good to me. I've got a great wife, good kids, money, my own health, but I'm lonely and I'm bored. I've often wondered why so many rich people commit suicide. Money sure isn't a cure-all. Now, 2,000 years ago, we find in the Bible the story of a lonely little man named Zacchaeus. And though we've had all the great technology since then and all of our advances in science, the basic needs of man have not changed. Here was a lonely man that had no friends. And one day Jesus sought him out by name. And you know what? Jesus is seeking you out by name tonight. You're here in this big crowd and you think, oh, nobody cares about me. Nobody notices me. You're wrong. God notices you. He cares about you. He loves you. And he's calling you by name to himself tonight. Just like he called this lonely little man that we'll read about, whose name was Zacchaeus. Let me tell you something. Jesus knew what it was like to be lonely. You say, oh, come on. How would he know what it's like? He's up in heaven. All the angels are up there. How could he have ever been lonely? But don't forget that the Bible says that Jesus was despised and rejected among men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And when he stepped toward that cross that he carried on your behalf, the Bible says, all of his disciples forsook him and fled. And then finally, when he hung on that cross and all of the sin of the world was placed upon him, he cried out the words, my God, why have you forsaken me? There's never been a lonelier man on this earth than Jesus when he cried those words. So he knows what it's like to be lonely. He knows what you're going through right now. And he wants to come into your life as he came into the life of Zacchaeus. Let's read the story in Luke chapter 19. We read these words, Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but he could not because of the crowd, because he was short of stature. So he ran ahead and climbed into a sycamore tree to see Jesus, for he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, that would be the religious leaders of the day, they said, hey, he's gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Then Zacchaeus said to the Lord, look, Lord, I'll give half of my goods to the poor, and if I've taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I'll restore four times what I took. And Jesus said, today salvation has come to this house, because he is a son of Abraham. The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. One of the first things we learn about Zacchaeus is that he was a tax collector. To be a member of this profession meant that you would be hated and isolated. You see, Zacchaeus was a Jew, but yet the Jewish people had the Romans take possession of their land, and they didn't like that one bit. They hated the Romans, but if there was one thing they hated even worse than the Romans, it was one of their own who joined up to work for the Romans, and that's what Zacchaeus did. You see, Zacchaeus was collecting taxes for Rome. But the Bible tells us he was rich, and if he was rich, that meant that he was taking more than he was supposed to get, because tax collectors could basically take the money that Rome wanted, and if they wanted anything on the top, they could just add it up and they could keep it for themselves. So Zacchaeus was skimming off the top. He was a ripoff artist. He was a thief. And though he had a lot of money and a lot of power, he had no friends. And then on top of all of that, there was that loneliness in his life. And when Jesus saw Zacchaeus, he called him. And I want you to look at God's assessment of Zacchaeus. It's in that final verse that we read in verse 10 of Luke 19, where we read that the Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost. Now that's interesting. Jesus didn't say, hey, Zacchaeus, you're a little thief, because he was. He didn't say, hey, Zacchaeus, you're ripping people off. Obviously, Jesus knew that. But Jesus got down to the bottom line. He got to the root of the problem. He said, the problem with Zacchaeus is he's lost. Now that's an interesting word in the original language. The word lost that is used here doesn't just mean something that is misplaced, like when you lose something. But the word lost speaks of something that is possessed, but has no value. Sort of like a broken watch. Now, I like to collect electronic gadgets. I'm a sap for gadgets. And if they come up with some new device that blow dries your hair, vacuums your house, and it's a shaver and an alarm clock, I'll get excited about it. But these things break quickly. And I have a drawer at home that's filled with little electronic gadgets that beep and chirp through the night, and I don't have any idea how to shut them off or reprogram them. You say, why don't you throw them away? I don't know, they just look kind of cool, and I think maybe one day I'll figure out how they work. I possess them, but they have no value. They don't function. They don't do anything except chirp and beep and take up space. The word that is used here of Zacchaeus is he was possessed, but he had no value. That speaks of a lot of people today. In a sense, we all have been created by God in his image. Now, we're not all God's children. We're all God's creation, but we're not his children until we come to him by faith. For the Bible says, for as many as received him, he gave them the power to become sons of God. But you have been made in the image of God. Animals haven't been made in God's image. You have. Animals are not on the same level as humanity. You are unique in that sense. But when you're living separated from God by sin, you are missing out on what God made you for. God made you to know Him. He made you to have a relationship with Him. He made you to one day join Him in eternity. And when you don't have that relationship with Him, you, like Zacchaeus, are wasting your life. Now, Jesus didn't get into the wrongs that Zacchaeus was doing. He got to the heart of the matter. We could talk a lot about different sins here tonight, different problems in our society. But when you get down to it, it's because you are lost that you look into drugs and sex and material things and pleasure to fill that emptiness in your life. If you get Christ in your life, the emptiness will be fulfilled and you'll no longer be chasing after those things that will never satisfy you. And so Jesus sought Zacchaeus out. Now, we read that when Jesus came to town, Zacchaeus ran ahead to meet him and scurried up a sycamore tree. Now, how did Zacchaeus know about Jesus? Did someone tell him? I mean, they might have looked at him and said, well, he would never listen to the gospel. He's rich and powerful. Sometimes we look at certain people, we say, oh, they have it all. Oh, they look so lucky. Oh, they're so together. They'd never listen to the gospel. You know, we see someone drive by in a Rolls Royce and we'd say, oh, they'd never want to hear about Jesus. You don't know what to say to them. Well, maybe ask for some Grey Poupon, I don't know. Well, let me tell you something. No matter how rich you are or how poor you are, how handsome you are, how ugly you are, if you're male or female, black, white, Asian, Hispanic, if you live in America or you live in Europe or Ethiopia, whoever you are, there are certain things that are true of every man and every woman. Number one, every man and every woman, no matter how wealthy or powerful, has an emptiness in their life. Now, I don't know you personally, necessarily, but there's an emptiness in your life because the Bible says we've been created with that emptiness. We've been made with it. There's a missing piece in your life tonight. You were born with it. Number two, everyone, in addition to the fact that they may be powerful or influential, is lonely, as we see with Zacchaeus. Thirdly, everyone is guilty. Everybody has a sense of guilt in their life. A psychiatrist said one time that if I could release, or if I could help people to understand that guilt is not real, I could release half of my patients. Because people come in with guilt that they can't shake. But let me tell you why you feel guilt. Because you're guilty. Simple as that. You feel guilt because you're guilty, because you're a sinner, just like I am. And we sense that guilt in our life because we've fallen short of God's standards, which are perfection. The Bible says, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. And if you're not perfect, you fall short of the glory of God. That is why it is absolutely absurd for you to say, hey, I don't need to go through Jesus Christ. I'll live a moral life. I'll live a good life. I'll be a religious person. I'll undergo a couple of religious rituals and I'll get to heaven. No, you won't. Because you've fallen short of God's standards. You're not perfect, and you've sinned, and that means that you need Jesus. Not only is every man and every woman empty, lonely, and guilty, but lastly, there is a universal fear of death. Oh, we may say, no, I'm not afraid to die, but you are afraid to die. And if you don't know Jesus Christ, you should be afraid to die. As Dave Drabecki already said, if you're born once, you'll die twice. But if you're born twice, you'll die once. What does that mean? If you're born once physically, you're going to die physically, and then you're going to die spiritually. But if you're born twice, which means born again, receiving Christ into your life as your personal Lord and Savior, you'll only die once. You'll leave this physical body, but you'll go into God's presence and live forever. That's a great promise. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. But if you don't know Jesus Christ personally, you're afraid to die right now. And I'm going to be real straightforward with you. What happens when you die? Well, if you're a Christian, you go to heaven. If you're a non-believer, you go to hell. A lot of preachers are afraid to say that today. If you're a Christian, you'll go to heaven. If you're not a Christian, you'll, well, it'll be difficult. You'll go to hell. Now, I don't enjoy saying that to you, but it's the truth. And if I don't say that to you, I'm not telling you the whole truth. You say, wait a second, you said hell. How could a God of love send people to hell? Good question. God doesn't send people to hell. People send themselves there. God didn't create hell for people. God did not create hell for people. The Bible says that hell was created for the devil and his angels. Satan, that once ranked high-ranking angelic being who rebelled against God, and the demons that followed him are going to hell. And all those that follow the devil are going to hell. But here's the twist. There's a lot of people tonight that are following the devil that don't even think he exists. That's one of his greatest scams that he's pulled off in humanity. They say, oh, the devil. What a joke, man. There's no devil. I'm in control of my own life. I'm the one that's in control. Funny, looks to me like someone's pulling the strings. I got news for you. The Bible says if you're not a Christian, that you have been blinded spiritually by the devil, who is called the god of this world. The Bible says that if you're not a Christian, you've been taken captive by the devil at his will. That means you're a spiritual hostage. And the worst thing of all is you don't even know you're in prison. And then someday you look out and you notice that other people have gotten out of their cells. How'd you do that? We just walked through the door. You don't have to live the way that you've been living, with that emptiness, with that loneliness, with that guilt, and with that fear of death. If you'll come to Jesus Christ, you can be changed, and you don't have to go to hell, but you can have the hope of heaven. And Zacchaeus heard about Jesus. Someone took the time to tell him, and someone took the time to tell you. I would venture to say that most of you that are visiting here tonight have been brought by a friend. You wanted to appease some persistent Christian friend, and here you are. Maybe they bribed you with a cheeseburger, or they said, oh, please come with me, and you came. But you can come to know Jesus Christ tonight, and you'll realize that's one of the best friends you ever had that brought you here. So there was Zacchaeus up in the tree, and Jesus sees him as he's walking by. And imagine this in your mind if you can. Here's this crowd of people. Wherever Jesus went, there were crowds pushing, pulling, grabbing, shoving, a cloud of dust probably around them, and they're moving along in this entourage. And then there's Zacchaeus up in the tree, bending down, trying to get a look at the Lord. And suddenly Jesus looks up, Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus thought, oh man, I'm in trouble now. He's gonna tell everyone what I've done. Zacchaeus, come down. I'm coming over to your house for a meal. Put it in California speak, let's do lunch. No, I'm just kidding. Far more important than that. I'm coming over to your house for a meal. Now, back in those days, to eat together was a sign of fellowship and closeness, and to say I'm coming over to have a meal with you was a commitment that Jesus was making that made a lot of people mad, especially religious people. But Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. He sought Zacchaeus out. And then Zacchaeus invited Jesus into his home, and he came out a different person. And he gave up some things. He made some changes. You may ask the question, well, listen, Greg, if I become a Christian tonight, will I have to give up anything? Will I have to change? The answer is yes. You will have to give up some things. But let me put it to you this way. It would be as if your little child picked up a dangerous object, maybe something sharp, and as they were holding it in their hand and you realized they could cut themselves, you said, honey, stop, give that to Dad. But you realize that they weren't going to give it to you because they were fascinated by it. So you think fast and you grab their favorite toy and you hold it up. You say, sweetheart, do you want this toy? The toddler said, yes, yes. Then give Dad what you're holding and you take it out of their hand and you put that toy in their hands. You see, you only took that thing away from them because they would hurt themselves with it. And you only took it away to give them something better in its place. Now you ask, do I have to give up anything to follow Jesus? Yes, you do. But whatever you give up for him, he'll give you something better in its place, and you will never miss it. Find out for yourself. The Apostle Paul said, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. I consider them rubbish that I may win Christ. Yeah, I've given up a few things to follow the Lord. I gave up emptiness, loneliness, guilt, and a destiny in hell. Wow, what a sacrifice. And God gave me forgiveness and peace and hope and the future in heaven. Yeah, you're going to have to give up some things, but whatever they are, they will pale when you compare them to what God will put in their place. So after Zacchaeus and Jesus went into this little house and reappeared before the crowd, this man was radically changed. Look, Lord, he said, I'll give four times to whoever I took from in an unlawful way. Now that's conversion, when a guy like this is willing to give back, and not only give back, but four times what he took. How could it happen so quickly? Doesn't conversion take months and years and even a lifetime? I'm going to convert. Some people say, I'm becoming a Christian. It doesn't take years. It doesn't take months. It doesn't take weeks. It can happen in a flash, instantaneously. Now, true, as you walk with God, that change will take place over a period of years, but the moment of receiving the forgiveness of sins and asking him to come in your life happens in a moment. You say, oh, no, come on, that's too good to be true. It's true. Jesus changed Zacchaeus, and Jesus can change you immediately. But I want you to notice there were changes in the life of this man. And if you are a true follower of Jesus Christ, there's going to be changes in your life. And people that say, yes, I'm a Christian, and there's been no changes in their life, and they continue to flagrantly break the standards of the Word of God, I suggest to you, they're not Christians. Because if you really know Christ, there's going to be changes outwardly as well as inwardly. You see, coming to Christ is having your eyes open spiritually, and then it's turning from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, and then you receive the forgiveness of sins. Some people have had their eyes open spiritually, which means that they acknowledge the truth of Jesus. They acknowledge he was the Son of God who died on the cross for them and rose again from the dead. But until there has been that turning from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, there's not been a conversion. It's not enough to intellectually ascribe to these things. There must be a change in your life, a moment where you say, Lord, come into my life. I turn from my sin and I turn to you. Have you done that yet? If not, would you like to? Jesus said something to Zacchaeus. Make haste. That means hurry up. Get down from that tree now. I'm coming to your house for a meal. And we need to do the same thing. Zacchaeus took immediate action and made a public stand, and so must you. Because we've all sinned, we all need to be forgiven, and there is an emptiness that all of the possessions and all of the relationships and all of the power this world offers. But it won't fill that emptiness. Sex won't fill it, religion won't fill it, pleasure won't fill it, violence won't fill it, fame won't fill it. Nothing will except Jesus Christ. He called Zacchaeus by name. He's calling you as well. You say, well, what do I need to do? What do I need to do to be forgiven of my sin? What do I need to do to be certain that when I die, I'll go to heaven? What do I need to do to get rid of this nagging guilt that haunts me day in and day out? Number one, you must recognize what God has done for you. Realize that God loved you so much, he sent his son to die on the cross in your place. You see, when Jesus hung on that cross 2,000 years ago, it was not an accident. It was always part of his plan. Because God knew there was no other way to settle the sin question. And when Jesus hung there on that cross, he did it for you. He died for you. He bled for you. He suffered for you. He bore your sin. He bore my sin. So I need to realize God did that for me. And number two, I must repent of my sins. Jesus said, unless you repent, you will perish. Zacchaeus made immediate changes in his life, and so must you. It's not enough to just be sorry. There's got to be change. I mean, some people are sorry they got caught. You know, a guy may rob a bank and the police come and arrest him. That guy's sorry. Why is he sorry? That he robbed the bank? No. That he got greedy, too greedy, and stayed to take more money and he got caught. And when he's paroled in a week, he'll be more careful next time. That's not repentance. That's just someone who's sorry he got caught. Now, some of us are sorry we've gotten caught. Some people who have gone out and have violated God's standards morally maybe are sorry for the results. They're sorry that they're pregnant. They're sorry that they've got the AIDS virus. They're sorry that something else has happened. But many of them don't even change their behavior after that. They're just sorry they got caught. Being sorry or repenting means to change the way that you're going. It means to change your direction. So you must repent of your sin, because the Bible says godly sorrow will produce repentance. If you're really sorry for what you've done, you'll change. Thirdly, you must receive Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. I already mentioned, as many as received Him, He gave them the right to become children of God. Fourthly, you must confess Christ publicly. You must make a public stand. And that's why in a moment, I'm going to ask you to come down to this center field behind the platform and ask you to make your public stand for Christ. He called Zacchaeus publicly, and Zacchaeus got up and came down. And number five, you must do it now. Make it happen now. Jesus said, make haste. You may not be up a tree, but you're up in a chair, and He's calling you. Make haste. Do it now. You say, oh, it would have been so nice to have Jesus over to your house. Imagine how the wife of Zacchaeus must have felt, if he had a wife, when he brought home Jesus, unannounced. Guys, have you ever done that to your wife? Brought home a guest without telling your wife, honey, I brought the boss home. Imagine what Zacchaeus' wife would have thought when he came home. Honey, I have a guest. Who is it, dear? Only Jesus Christ, the creator of the universe. Wow. You say, oh, but that was 2,000 years ago. I can't have Jesus in my house. But you can, in a sense. Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock, and if you'll hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. He wants to come into your life, into your heart, into your home. Maybe your family's hanging by a thread right now. He wants to come and put your home back together. Maybe your life is falling apart. He wants to be a part of it. Maybe your business is unraveling. He wants to help you. Maybe your life is going down the tubes. He wants to help you. Maybe you're addicted to drugs or to alcohol. Whatever your problem is, He wants to come in. He wants to do some house cleaning. But you've got to open the door and say, Lord, come on in. He stands at the door and knocks. If you'll hear His voice and open the door, He will come in. Are you ready to open that door tonight and ask Christ to come in? If you will open it, He will come in. What do you need to do? Realize what He did for you. Turn from your sin. Receive Him into your life as Savior and Lord. Do it publicly and do it now. In a moment, we're going to pray. And I'm going to ask you to make your public stand for Jesus Christ. Just as He called this lonely little man Zacchaeus 2,000 years ago, He's calling you. Whoever you are, whatever you've done. And I'm going to ask you, if you're serious about knowing Him, to get up out of your seat in a moment and come down to this center field and pray and receive Christ. Let's pray now. Father, we thank You for Your love. We thank You for the truth of the gospel. And we thank You for the people that are ready now to receive what You have for them. Help them to stand up and follow You, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Jesus said, if you'll confess Me before men, I'll confess you before My Father who is in heaven. But if you deny Me before men, I'll deny you before My Father. It's time to make a public stand for Him. If you want your sin forgiven, if you want to know that when you die you'll go to heaven, if you want your guilt taken away, I'm going to ask you to get up out of your seat wherever you're standing and make your way quickly down to the field here. And we're going to have you come out to the center field and we're going to lead you in prayer. Up on the top, you need to start coming down those stairs now. In the middle, do the same. Get up and come. Now is the time. Up on the top, it will take you a little bit longer. So make your way down now. Do it quickly.
Lord, look upon my need. I need you. I need you. Oh Lord, have mercy now on me.
Back up here. Make your way down. Wherever you're sitting, come down to center field. Get up and come.
And I will be clean. Lord, look upon my need. I need you. I need you. Lord, have mercy now on me. Forgive
of all of us, whoever you are, whatever you have, whoever you know. Do you know God? Is your sin forgiven? If you were to die tonight, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You make that decision right now by what you do with Jesus Christ. You're not too young to come to Him tonight. You're not too old. You're not too moral and good. We've all sinned. But on the other hand, you're not too immoral and sinful. He'll forgive you, but you must come. Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Come, there's still time. Up on the top, you can come down. Around the back here, make your way down to center field. You'll never regret it. Come now.
We're so glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 24215, APO, Richmond, British Columbia, V7B1Y2. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, till next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program was brought to you by the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.